Water is life. And for those of us who live in the Lower Mainland, the water we drink comes from three major reservoirs. And it's the job of the Greater Vancouver Regional District to maintain water quality. Over the next 30 years, clean, safe water could cost us in excess of $1 billion. Last year, the GVRD released this report, which detailed the quality of the Lower Mainland's drinking water. And while the list includes trace elements all the way from arsenic to zinc, a concoction that hardly sounds tasty, the GVRD maintains that Vancouver and the Lower Mainland's drinking water supply is still relatively safe.
The system is set up for the majority of the people. And there may be people, just like there are industries or commercial facilities that need better water quality than drinking water quality. We're not supplying a sterile water. We're not boiling it ahead of time. We're providing a drinking water that for 99% of the people is fine the way it is.
So why then is the GVRD planning to spend huge taxpayer dollars on infrastructure improvements? Because studies say the public is simply demanding cleaner drinking water. Coastal Mountain Water is one of several private firms producing a product to meet increasing consumer demand for pure water.
For the GVRD to make water to the level of quality that we have, I don't know that it would be economically viable for them to do so.
The company says through the process of ozonation, they're purifying the water without the use of chlorine, something the GVRD has been adding to our water supply for years.
Chlorine itself has been known to mix with organic compounds to form trihalomethanes, which are cancer-causing agents. The ozone, it will actually dissipate into the air, so it will actually not be present in the water after 5 hours.
The GVRD explains they're not trying to compete with the pure water companies. Their mandate is to provide a clean product on a massive level. And they say if people prefer the taste of bottled water, all the more power to them. Does this look like a machine that could revolutionize the transportation industry and help clean up the planet's smog problem? Well, according to engineers at North Vancouver's Ballard Power Systems, the fuel cell is the clean-burning, ultra-efficient engine of the future.
The process of taking the hydrogen that comes out of methanol or natural gas and converting it into electricity is done electrochemically without combustion. And that process is clean, it's efficient, and it's quiet. And that's what makes the fuel cell so much more attractive than the existing sources of power, like an internal combustion engine, for example.
And this is the effect of the internal combustion engine on our environment. Experts agree the air care program simply is not enough and tell us our personal driving habits will have to change. But since few expect the North American love affair with the automobile to end soon, the question remains, will motorists dish out big dollars for these clean cars?
If you look at the cost of pollution today, in terms of health care, in terms of cleanup costs, and then you add that up and then look at the cost of a competing solution. So you have to look at what we call the total life cycle cost. You can't just look at the cost of a very narrow, specific area, such as just the engine.
Here is what Ballard believes to be the future of environmentally friendly transportation. It's their prototype zero-emission vehicle, or ZEV. As for the local company, the president says there's nothing but clear skies ahead.
I think you will see prototypes by 97, 98, and I think mass production by the year 2003. And what's magical about the year 2003 is that's the year when the California zero-emission vehicle regulations come into play. So if any auto manufacturer that wants to sell cars in California has to have zero-emission vehicles, we believe that our fuel cell and the engine that is based on this fuel cell will be the engine of the future.
The human drama of athletic competition is about to unfold here at the Coach House Inn in North Vancouver. And any time you combine fat guys, beer, and diving, you certainly have the makings for a great sporting event. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Beer Belly Splash 93.
Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come on and fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's float down to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come on, fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so very near, you might even hear a whole gang of cheers just because we're together. Weather-wise, it's such a cuckoo day. You just say those words and we'll take our birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's so perfect for a flying honeymoon. Oh, babe, come fly with me. Let's fly, let's fly. Pack up, let's fly away.
And don't tell your mama.
Tale as old as time, true as it can be. Barely even friends, then somebody bends unexpectedly.
As in bending over backwards. That's what one Vancouver animation house says the BC Trade and Development Corporation is doing to ensure Disney sets up shop in town. Studio B Productions is one of the city's premier animation facilities, employing some of Canada's most talented artists and producing a variety of award-winning cartoons. Yet the studio's owners say after 5 years in business, they've never once gone cap in hand to the province.
Yeah. We haven't asked the government for any handouts, but if there are handouts to be made and Disney is getting them, there's going to be a lot of upset people in the business because no one's made those avenues available to us.
The other half of the Studio B team explains while he welcomes the competition from the entertainment giant, he's suspicious of BC Trade's open arms treatment of Disney.
What have we been doing for the last 10 years here? You know, they don't recognize us. We're sitting here paying our taxes and all that, but you know, nobody's recognizing us, but that's fair enough. But yeah, it leads you to believe that there is something going on. But again, you can't be sure, you know, you really can't be sure. More than likely there is, because there always is in big business.
At BC Trade, we were met only by security.
Gary Fowley of the BC Trade and Development Corporation will not appear live on camera. He says right now that negotiations between Disney and the government are ongoing, and the Trade and Development Corporation is working as a liaison between the two. He does say, though, however, that within 2 weeks, an agreement to bring Disney to Vancouver once and for all will be announced.
And at the offices of the BC Film Commission, an agency created, amongst other things, to protect cultural industries and support small made-in-BC films, more closed doors. While the knives aren't out for Disney yet, there is anger expressed by the small independent studios, especially with the possible exodus of talent to the American company. And at least for the time being, they're not crying.
And stay out!
Dave Jackson, Vancouver.
The expansion committee unanimously recommended a franchise to be granted to Vancouver for the 1995-96 season.
The group headed by Griffiths includes his sister Emily and local businessman Tom Skidmore. But before there's a tip-off in the new arena, ownership still has a couple of shots to sink. Final approval by the league and the sale of 15,000 season's tickets by year's end.
When I first heard the number, I must admit I reacted as I think most of you would have and said, gee, that's a lot. But the reality is 15,000 is accomplishable. I don't think the number is that unachievable, and in fact, that just goes to show you that you have a solid business when you can start with the base of that.
But not everyone shares in that optimism. Veteran sports writer Jim Taylor says there may be dark clouds ahead.
I know there are thousands and thousands of kids wearing all this stuff. My question is, do kids buy tickets? I'm a bit of a pessimist, but I don't know. In that kind of numbers, people are going to have to make choices. I don't think Joe Citizen sitting in the bar is going to be able to go to both hockey and basketball.
So we visited a Vancouver watering hole to see if Joe Citizen was willing to free throw about $2,000 a year on a single season's ticket.
I'll get to the odd game, but I wouldn't get a season ticket and I just couldn't afford it.
All depends on what kind of teams come here, and you know, I wouldn't get a season ticket.
The first couple of years are going to be pretty tough, and you know, if they have a losing team, I don't think a lot of people are going to go out to see them.
I don't think I'll be buying season tickets, but I think that I'll be interested in going to at least a few games every year.
As construction of the multi-million dollar sports complex speeds ahead, so does the marketing and promotion of the Mounties. The only question now is, will the already cash-strapped sports fan take the pass? Dave Jackson, Vancouver.
You going to show us how to do that?
A sunny afternoon at English Bay. A dog burying a bone as the waves gently signal another lazy day in Lotus Land. And as this reporter scans the beach looking for a story, a solitary beachcomber pokes away at the sand, searching for buried treasure like some high-tech Long John Silver, begging the question.
What got you involved in this? Like, why did you, one day did you just sort of think, hey, what the heck?
Well,
let's
no, it's just that I used to live in Calgary, and I guess like there was a lot of Americans had moved up there, and that's where it all started, you know, in the States. And I had watched some of these from the States that had moved in there, and they were using these machines. And it just seemed interesting, you know.
Uh-huh.
And then when I come to BC, I just saw one and I decided to get one.
Well, you know, this is where all the money is now, so it's like pennies from heaven here.
That's right, yeah.
And he's been foraging for man's flotsam and jetsam for over 15 years. A retired miner who's traded in a pickaxe for a computerized metal detector, rarely overlooking even the smallest denomination.
Penny for your thoughts. Oh, a quarter.
Oh, look at this.
Looks like a loon.
Loony.
Buck and a quarter in the last 5 minutes. That's not bad.
He has no wife or children, but he says he's content every day digging away at the beach, rain or shine. And while he's never struck it rich, he says wealth is measured in different ways, like peace of mind. Dave Jackson, Vancouver. Welcome to Family Place. Throughout British Columbia, we provide a unique service that both adults and children alike have come to cherish. Our philosophy is a simple one: to offer families a friendly, safe, and supportive environment where we can encourage children's social interaction through play and learning. In short, Family Place says it all. A place that offers friendship and fun for the whole family. Founded on Vancouver's west side nearly 20 years ago, Family Place was created by two young mothers with a common goal in mind, that adults and children should have an environment where they can both grow and nurture. Family Place is not a daycare facility, but a venue designed to help parents out. The Family Place model was developed in response to the fact that parenting and caring for young children is very demanding, and made more so by the stress and isolation that so many parents and caregivers experience today. Family Places provide a range of programs designed to meet the needs of families living in a particular neighborhood.
Well, a couple of times a week.
Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, he likes it. It's good.
Although each center has its own uniqueness, all centers have a common commitment to build on family strengths and motivation, to encourage and support positive parent-child relationships, to provide opportunities about parenting and child development, and to increase family involvement in the community. As board members meet to discuss family place planning, they recognize the importance of interdependence of family members, and that family places should reflect the multicultural nature of the community. They also believe that programs provided to children and adults should be mutually beneficial. Family places should also foster cooperative decision-making among program participants, staff, and the community, because our programs are most effective when they're part of the neighborhood.
So I can whip one out and give one out.
That's why a specific invitation to a certain age group is more inviting.
I wonder if I get a fix from Family Place.
Raising users, awareness,
PR awareness.
So Tanya, you've been coming to Family Place for quite a while?
For about a year, I guess, yeah. When my oldest son, Keen, was a year old, we started coming here.
And what was your original reason for coming?
Let's see. I went to a Christmas craft fair, and a lady there, Marnie, told us about it. We had gone to a couple of other drop-in centers, and the only thing I didn't like about them is it seemed to focus more on the adults, and the kids were just left sitting on the floor with nothing to do. Whereas a Family Place, I went in, and there was all these toys everywhere, as well as coffee and eating areas for the adults and the kids, and just an all-around good approach, I thought. So we came back often, needless to say.
So what do you like about coming here?
I like getting out of the house. The days that I'm at home with just two kids and the same old toys and just cleaning up after them all the time is deadly. So I like coming here, finding other people to talk to, finding other kids for the kids to talk to. And then we all have a good place. Did for me is teach me some parenting skills just through osmosis, just through talking to people and seeing, you know, what you can do differently than your parents did 40 years ago.
Really?
Which a lot has changed, yeah. Things like not spanking, which I didn't know what I was going to do with my kids. But it gives you a chance to talk to other people about, we're taking a Nobody's Perfect class right now, which is specifically a parenting class, and is to teach you to deal with.
I've been coming to Family Place, I guess, for about 3 years now, and it was my salvation, let me tell you.
So what was your original reason?
Original reason? Well, I thought about, I'm not a person who is used to being at home with children with no stimulation and no outside people. So I had heard about this place, so I brought the kids when they were about a year to a year and a half old. I thought, this is my big salvation because I now can be with other moms who are going through much the same thing that I'm going through. Gets me out of the house, a new environment, and is a great support group here. Mike and Chanel love it here. It's very a lot. Now they're at the wrecking stage, but before this, they were primarily into role-playing. Mike used to get the trucks and the trains and play independently with that, and Chanel would always go to the kitchen and make meals for everybody, and they like the dress-up, and they like the music.
May there always be sunshine, may there always be blue skies, may there always
The grieving family of Jesse Cadman filed in here at New Westminster Supreme Court to hear the first day of testimony in the second-degree murder trial of 18-year-old Isaac Dees, who's accused of killing their son. Cadman was beaten and stabbed to death a year and a half ago as he returned home from a party. The accused, a young offender at the time of the attack, allegedly told police he was looking for trouble the night of the brutal slaying. But Jesse's father, Chuck Cadman, says time has not healed the wounds.
I've lived that over and over again, believe me.
Yeah. Hearing it in court, dispassionately.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've heard it before. And it's, it doesn't get any easier. Doesn't matter how many times you hear it, it doesn't get any easier to deal with.
Special ribbons were worn by friends, family, and schoolmates as a reminder of the popular teen struck down in a random and senseless act of violence. The trial is expected to last about 3 weeks. Dave Jackson, New Westminster.
Vancouver, the street of dreams for so many musicians. And for one of Canada's most enduring independent rockers, those dreams have become a sensible reality.
Well, they gave him his orders down in Monroe, Virginia. Started running way behind time. This is not the 38, it's the old 97. Better get a dispenser on time.
Music, like any art form, is subject to fads and follies. But after 15 years in the business, Eugene Ripper has found a comfort zone. He's created a balance between a career as a freelance journalist and as an active musician. And he says he's never compromised his climb to the top of the nightclub heap by selling out to whatever top 40 sound is in fashion. A veteran of the Toronto and Vancouver club and concert scene, the former CASBY Award nominee for Best Independent Artist explains how his current roots rock and roll persona evolved in the early days in TO.
We were sort of a surf and destroy, suburban, surfabilly, satirical rock punk band, Stark Naked and Fleshtones. And that was sort of where it all began, back in the late 70s and early 80s, back in Hogtown. Into it. Rob, our drummer, has a heavy reggae ska influence, so that's working into the material now. And Randy has a real strong rock and hard rock sensibility in the material that we're writing these days. You know, all these elements. And surprisingly, you know, it's not far from what I started off with my first band. It's just got new elements, but we all cherish that that element of spontaneous, unaffected rock and roll.
So I asked this spontaneous rock and roller his top five list of what makes a real rock band.
Is grit, honesty, melody, beat, and pizza. Top five elements in rock and roll.
Don't take yourself too seriously, dude. Maybe best exemplified in his lighthearted hit, Peking Hop. After all, it's only rock and roll.
rocking. It's only rocking. It's only rocking.
Hi, and welcome to BCIT Magazine for April 20th. I'm Dave Jackson. One of the most highly publicized murder cases of the past year throughout the Lower Mainland is about to unfold in this courthouse behind me. A Surrey youth stands accused of killing 16-year-old Jesse Cadman just over a year ago.
The grieving family of Jesse Cadman filed in here at New Westminster Supreme Court to hear the first day of testimony in the second-degree murder trial of 18-year-old Isaac Dees, who's accused of killing their son. Cadman was beaten and stabbed to death a year and a half ago as he returned home from a party. The accused, a young offender at the time of the attack, allegedly told police he was looking for trouble the night of the brutal slaying. But Jesse's father, Chuck Cadman, says time has not healed the wounds.
I've lived that over and over again, believe me.
But hearing it in court, dispassionately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've heard it before. And it doesn't get any easier. Doesn't matter how many times you hear it, it doesn't get any easier to deal with.
Special ribbons were worn by friends, family, and schoolmates as a reminder of the popular teen struck down in a random and senseless act of violence. The trial is expected to last about 3 weeks.
Vancouver police are busy trying to solve the murders of two brothers. Ronnie Dosange was shot and killed yesterday while driving along Kingsway, and his brother Jimmy was involved in a gangland-style murder just over a month ago. Jimmy Dosange was reported to be an underworld hitman, and police are following that lead with his brother's death as well.
They're off at the much-anticipated opening of the brand new track. Yes, there's a new name, new management, and more than $1 million of facility improvements. So what kind of facelift can race fans expect to see?
The major change in terms of cost was totally redoing the entire food service operation. We had to strip and redo every bar, every lounge, every restaurant, every concession stand, and that was a very significant cost. It just had to be done. And we painted everything. We changed tote systems to get a more state-of-the-art system that will handle tickets faster and will also accommodate more self-service machines, and that was a very significant cost. A new starting gate, it just kind of goes on and on.
Jockeys and horsemen alike are naturally happy to see a complete resurfacing of the bumpy old track, but plans to lengthen the 5/8 mile race course have been put on hold.
The problem as I see it is that lengthening the stretch doesn't really solve their problem. If they can't widen the whole track so you have a wider oval, all that they'll achieve is to get horses running faster into the same tight corners. And the corners are where most of the injuries occur. Apart from the backstretch, which has always been notorious here for being having potholes in it. And they seem to have solved a lot of that problem, and as long as they can maintain it.
Whether it was the cold beer, a few dollars won, or simply liking all the new stuff, most race fans were happy with the changes.
I think the clubhouse here has really improved. I like it a lot. It's a lot brighter.
It's green, and that's good, environmentally friendly, I guess.
I really think they needed painting and updating, and I like the TVs that are in.
However, the introduction of fine pastries and lattes didn't seem to go over too well with the more down-home meat-eating crowd.
There's only one thing, that they've left these roast beef sandwiches off that they used to have.
They don't have the roast beef sandwiches.
What about the disastrous decision to excommunicate the roast beef sandwich?
Oh, well, that's a sad. That's real sad. Buddy, buddy.
Yes, the timeless hot dog still remains. And the stars of the show will always be the thoroughbreds, even if they don't quite live up to every horse player's expectations. Dave Jackson, Vancouver.
Welcome to BCIT Magazine. on today's program. The dock worker strike ends, but bitterness continues. A Carisdale senior's apartment catches fire.
Oh, I could smell the smoke and the billowing coming up and the fire alarm ringing.
Good evening and welcome to this week's edition of BCIT Magazine. Dave?
Thanks, Corey. The federal government has cut taxes on cigarettes in the hope of reducing what has become a thriving trade in smuggled smokes. Some provinces may also lower their taxes, but BC Premier Mike Harcourt says that won't happen here. Quebec, on the other hand, has already cut its taxes. The smuggling problem there is the worst in the country. As many as two-thirds of all cigarettes sold there are illegal. Whether the $5 federal tax cut will slow smuggling remains to be seen. But as Rhonda Stewartson found, the black market has been growing steadily.
Part one of the Canada Labour Code.
Other parties which rely on the port, such as prairie grain farmers, Vancouver rail workers, and independent truckers, will be more than happy to see the docks working again. As for the longshoremen, they say it's going to be a long road before they feel any positivity. Greg Neumeier, Vancouver.
The Vancouver group bidding for an NBA expansion franchise has dribbled around another obstacle. Northwest Sports says it has an agreement in principle with the BC government to remove basketball betting from the province's sports lottery if Vancouver is awarded an NBA franchise. Colin Thomas has more.
Yan, Rhonda Stewartson, Vancouver.
Icy road conditions have caused some serious traffic problems this week. A truck and van collided near BCIT at Mosscrop and Weyburn. Those involved were shaken up, but no one was injured. The van was damaged quite extensively, but cleanup crews managed to get things in order without traffic delays.
I don't need your camera either, guy.
To stand trial for his arrest in Clockwet Sound last year, Greg Neumeier, Vancouver.
And Harcourt was quick to react to European sentiment concerning BC's clear-cutting record when he arrived back from his trip. The Premier labeled Europeans as eco-imperialists and says clear-cutting practices in Europe have a bad history as well.
In Germany and...
...section at a community open house next week. Lillian L., North Vancouver.
About 50 New Westminster garbage collectors went on a one-day wildcat strike to protest the 10-day suspension of a co-worker. The unnamed employee apparently picked up a garbage bag full of dog excrement. The contents of the bag exploded as the garbage truck's compactor crushed the bag. Reporter Lillian Au spoke to one worker who witnessed the incident.
One of the more unpleasant...
Vancouver.
It's Grey Cup 2014, and the Grey Cup Festival is one of the great unifying events that brings CFL fans together from coast to coast in a spirit of good football and good times.
But with nearly 3,000 tickets still unsold less than 48 hours prior to kickoff, the question remains, have too many recent big-time sporting events in Vancouver and the BC Lions not making it to the big game affected ticket sales and fan interest?
Because it's a Grey Cup, we're all football fans.
Yeah.
We're a CFL fan, and it's good to see Hamilton in it.
Yeah.
It's just the party. Brings the nation together.
A little bit down because you're in a bigger city. When you're in,
when the home team's not in there, it's a little bit of a harder sell. But I think between now and game time, I mean, I was heard that they sold 400 or 500 tickets in the last 2 days. So from to that, they're less to 1,000. I bet you by now it's less than 1,000. I think it'll be pretty close to being sold.
And it's a 55,000 seat stadium, so it's still a good crowd. Even if it's not sold out, it's probably going to be the biggest crowd of the year.
So. I have faith. We'll sell out.
It's not just Stamps fans, but organizers and ticket brokers say they're confident the 102nd Grey Cup will be a sellout come game time. Ticket broker Kingsley Bailey echoes that sentiment.
This is probably one of the most, the sport where every single fan of every single team is in the building and they get along, and they get along well. And you can't say that about soccer. You can't say that about NFL.
The overall success of an event as huge as the Grey Cup cannot be simply measured in dollars and cents. For over 100 years, diehard CFL fans from across Canada have made the Grey Cup an event that transcends mere money.